We're going to be talking about conflict, disarming conflict, and the pursuit of resolution of conflict by means other than military means. You probably noticed or read or saw that amongst the many presidential tweets that we've been subjected to over the last while, one of them was, we have to win. We have to start winning wars again. That's what President Trump said a while back, not so very long ago. And of course, he's right in implying that the U.S. has not been winning wars recently. That's absolutely correct. But he's not so correct in implying that the reason is the lack of military capacity and military capability. In fact, states have been losing wars in the last quarter century much, much more than they've been winning them, losing wars against insurgencies and so forth. And so that the prevailing experience of wars in the last quarter century, since the end of the Cold War, has been that superior military force has not been winning wars, has not had the capacity to impose its will on much inferior power bases and so forth. So states with superior military force impose states with superior military force are unsuccessful in imposing their will on military forces that are far inferior to them, and that's the prevailing experience. That's not the exception in the post-Cold War era. You remember that you'll recall that Clausewitz, the great 19th century strategist, 18th and 19th century strategist, defined war as the use of force to compel your adversary to fulfill or bow to your will. That's the objective of diplomacy and politics, is to persuade your adversary to see the wisdom of your view and to cooperate with it. And as he said, war is simply that, diplomacy by other means. When you can't do it by means of diplomacy and persuasion, then you have available to you force and war by which you can do that. Well, the General Sir Rupert Smith, a well-known British general who wrote a great book on the subject and commanded a number of UN peacekeeping operations, observed this about contemporary wars, and I'm quoting. He says, contemporary wars have spectacularly failed to achieve the results intended, namely a decisive military victory, which would in turn deliver a solution to the original problem, which is usually political. So if you, that's what is meant by the successful resort to force, is that you actually resolve the issues that led to the use of force in the first place. And General James Mattis, who is now the U.S. Secretary of Defense, seemed to have an understanding of this in 2013, when he said, if you don't fund the State Department fully, then I have to buy more ammunition ultimately. Well, he's right in part. He's right in the sense that ultimately the resolution of political conflict is the work of the State Department, is the work of diplomacy and political resolution. He's wrong in implying that if you neglect diplomacy, you can make up for that neglect by greater military power. It's one of the the myths that still strongly prevail. It's It's advanced somewhat also by the just war doctrine. Just war doctrine says that military force must be absolutely the last resort. When you've exhausted all other options, only then do you go to military force. But the implication of that is that after you've exhausted all of the options, there's still a solution available. And that solution that is still available is finally the resort to force. But experience, in fact, demonstrates that if all other means of resolving a conflict are failing, then military force is apt to fail as well. So it's unlikely that it's going to be able to do what other means are not doing. So here's that leads to the question, and that is: are these what I've been saying now? Is that just simply the kind of the ideological assertions of a peacenik, or is there actually something behind this? Is the military force actually ineffective in producing the outcomes that we want to produce? Well, so to look at that question, at Plowshares that we had been monitoring armed conflicts ever since 1987, just before the end of the Cold War. We started this business, this practice of an annual armed conflicts report, and various people have worked on it, and including some here. And we've maintained a record of those conflicts over the years, and amongst other things, paid some attention to how those wars end. And the evidence that I'm going to go through is that is what I've been saying, that the superior military force consistently is unable to impose its will when the conflict is essentially political. Of course, there's many things that military force does quite effectively. If you tell a military commander that I want to capture that particular hill, then the commander is likely to be able to say, well, if I have these kind of forces and have a clear understanding of what the counter forces are and what the objective are, I can do it with such and such a capacity, and they have a pretty good capacity to seek and produce military ends in some reasonably predictable way. The military force is very effective in regime destruction, but they usually cite it as regime change, as in the attack on Iraq. But in fact, the military forces, as we've seen, are incapable of producing the regime change. What they do is destroy a particular regime, and then kind of wait to see what's going to come up in its place. So I'm going to look at these wars of the last quarter century for a little bit, and then after that make some comments about war prevention and disarming conflict, about the alternative pursuits for the resolution of conflict. So defining war isn't obvious. One of the things about contemporary war, it's not clear when they begin and when they end. Contemporary wars, particularly civil wars, which is what virtually all wars these days are, and that requires some context and caveats, but virtually all wars are civil wars these days, and they don't begin by a declaration of war or an act of parliament and say that we're declaring war on you as we declare war on Germany or another country. That's not how they start. They start by sort of progressive disaffection of communities and political forces within a country, gradually declining respect for the political institutions of the country, gradually leading to increased violence until at some point, when you counter that political opposition with force, you find yourself in conditions that are basically the equivalent of war. So it's not, so when it begins and when it ends isn't obvious. So you have to be somewhat arbitrary about saying, if you're going to count wars, you've got to be a little bit arbitrary about when they begin and when the end. The standard definition, which is the one that we've used at Plowshares, is fairly simple, although all of them have nuances to them. And one is that the fighting is political, and that's to distinguish it from criminal violence. So that, for example, in the armed conflicts database of Project Plowshares, the Mexican drug wars have never been included, even though they've killed many people. The armed forces of the country are involved in combating the drug cartels, but it's not political in the sense that the objective is to change the political regime or to change the shape of the state. They have huge political impact. There's no question about that. But these are criminal activities. So the distinction is that the fighting is political, and it engages the security forces of a state and then this is the kind of the arbitrary part of it, is that there have been at least 1,000 combat deaths. So if you cross that line, then you get put into the war column, and if it's 999, then you're not. So it's arbitrary, but you need to be arbitrary in some sense. And and wars end when there is a settlement, and the annual death toll by combat. This is not, combat deaths is something different than indirect deaths. I mean, many people die because of war, because of homelessness that it's created and the loss of access to basic services and so forth. So many people die because of war that are not combat deaths. So, but we're talking here about only combat deaths. Or if for 2 years running, the combat death total is below 25, then we take it out of the war column and say it's no longer a war. So that's the basic definition of a war. And then I'll ask your patience a little bit on this next slide. This is just kind of a summary of the tally of the wars from 1989 through 2014, that quarter, that first post-Cold War quarter century. At the beginning of that period, in 1989, there were 35 wars, by that earlier definition, 35 wars were in progress. During the 25 years, another 54 wars started. So that in the first quarter, post-Cold War quarter century, just a little bit more than two new wars per year started. But so that gets you to a total of 89 wars. But there were also 64 wars that ended during that period, so that more than two wars per year ended, and particularly in the years of the Cold War, there was, you know, in Africa, Namibia, and places like that, came to a fairly quick end. And so it was also a good couple of decades for reduction of war. So 10 more wars end than were started. So from that, we started with 35. So then we're down to 25 wars existing. But some wars end and then resume again. So of those wars, this is 64 that ended, 10 resumed. So and in our database they count as a separate and new war. And so that's kind of a recidivism rate that isn't really high, but it's there. And then of those wars that review, six of those ended. So that left us with at the bottom then with 29 wars currently, and we could talk a little bit about what where they are. Some of them are obvious. And but there are others that we don't think of so much. Algeria is still in a state of war. By that definition, there are still combat deaths for political purposes in excess of the minimum in Algeria each year. Ethiopia over the Ogaden and Oromo areas. Kenya is still plagued with political violence. It really ratcheted up after 2007. There was major political violence after that election, but it still continues. Mali, we know is at war because Canada is considering sending people there. Nigeria, Boko Haram in the northeast, there's major fighting. Somalia, South Sudan is now one of the more intense wars in addition to Syria and Iraq and Libya and Afghanistan and a couple of types of war in India, and I'll get into that. Ukraine, the Caucasus region of Russia, these are all areas in which there is political violence in excess of the minimum standards definition of war. So that's these 29. I just mentioned them. 10 are in Africa, 9 in Asia, 2 in Europe. Europe, that's the Caucasus and Ukraine. 1 in the Western Hemisphere, and it's virtually over, and that's Colombia. And it might. By the definition, may be off the list by now, and 7 in the Middle East, and then briefly on the types of war. What's the objective sought by these wars that we've been encountering? Well, the basic one is state control. That's so. If you're fighting the regime to get it out of power and to put yourself or someone or some alternative. If you're really the good guys, you're fighting the regime to get it out of power so that there can be free and democratic elections later, or so that you can take over. And the war in Afghanistan is clearly that. The war in Iraq is that. The war in Syria is that. There are multiple motivations, and then there's ISIS in the mix of all of that. That just complicates it enormously. But the basic civil war, there are state control wars, and then there are state formation wars, and that's where the objective is not to take over central power, but to separate yourself from it. I mean, these are wars of secession, essentially, so that the long-term war of South Sudan against the Southern Sudan against the North to create a South Sudan state was a war of state formation. They wanted to alter the form that the state of Sudan took, and. In some instances there are both of those in the Philippines, for example. There's the New People's Army is a Marxist movement fighting against the government, has for many years low-level conflict, but still above the threshold, trying to overthrow the central government. They don't have a lot of opportunity, a lot of likelihood, not much likelihood of success, but that it's a long-term war, so that's a state control war. But at the same time, in Mindanao, there's an Islamist-led separation movement that's trying for independence of that region. I think they've modified that now, and so that would be state to all the state formation. And then failed state wars, and those are wars that are becoming more prominent. And this is where the objective is not to overthrow the regime. The objective is not to separate part of the regime or to create greater autonomy in one region or the other. But it's because of lack of governance and any capacity for the government to be an effective mediating instrument in a conflict. So the Kenyan violence is a good example of that. It has a couple of expressions. One is in the nomadic regions, the cow herding regions. There are conflicts between rival groups, and this is almost also a climate change war. And in the fact that the grazing lands are reducing, water is becoming more scarce, and so there's increased conflict for access to pasture lands and so forth. And the Kenyan government in Nairobi simply does not have the capacity or the means to mediate that conflict effectively, and so it leads to local. And the other part of it is ethnic clashes in the Rift Valley area, which are left over from the 2007 thing, which have their roots, deep roots, in the British colonial experience and the way in which the British tried to manipulate ethnic communities and which ones they favored and which ones they didn't. They gave some land in the areas of other of where in the traditional homelands of other areas, and that has kept developed long-term conflicts which are still being played out. So that's a failed state war, and there just isn't the capacity to deal with it effectively. And some are hybrids of that. The war in the South Sudan was a combination of it. It was basically a state formation war, a war for fighting for the separation of the South from the North. But within that, there were internecine tribal ethnic group conflicts. There were conflicts within the Nuer community itself, conflicts between the Nuer and the Dinka, and now it's a major struggle for power, which is really, devolved into a major ethnic power struggle between Dinka and Nuer. I mean, some of you may be expert on Sudan and will say immediately it's not quite as simple as that, and I'd agree. But it's a core element of it. Those are the four basic types of war. These are photos that illustrate types of war, and there are two more which I didn't mention, but which are your question referred. So that's the one up in the upper left is the cattle. That's a cattle herder in the Turkana Karamojong area on the border of Uganda and Kenya. And there, where there's competition over land, access to land, and a great deal, and there's a lot of cattle raiding, which is also related to traditional practices of dowry and that sort of thing. But the main thing is the environmentally produced high levels of competition for grazing land for cattle, and so that's a cattle herder. But you see the Kalashnikov there. And there are annually continue to be clashes there, it's really an area that's outside of the area over which the government of Kenya has much influence and control. So that's a failed state war, in that region. This the upper right hand, that's in the Philippines. And that's the New People's Army on the march, fighting against the central government. That's a state control. It's a somewhat obscure war, and could have used Afghanistan or other illustrations for that. But that's that kind of war. Then in the bottom left-hand corner is Thailand, and it's a bombed car in the south of Thailand, where it's Malay, I think it is, Malay rebel groups, Islamist, so a religious distinction from the mainstream of Thailand, who do not view themselves really to be part of the Thai nation, and they're fighting for independence and separation. So that's a state formation war, and it's a current one. It's going on. Then in the lower left-hand corner, that's in the Badme Triangle of the territory between Eritrea and Ethiopia in 2001. Major war between Eritrea and Ethiopia over a piece of barren desert land that was the ostensible focus of the war, but it's much more a political conflict between the two countries. And they had a very major tank battles during that period, either 2000 or 2001, and there was one weekend there in which there was a very conventional tank war between Eritrea and Ethiopia, in which there were something like 70,000 military personnel on both sides killed over the course of a weekend, which got virtually no press in this area. So that's from a while back. So that's from, so I've forgotten whether it's 2000 or 2001 where that picture was taken. And then this picture of the aircraft, that's a Canadian F-18 aircraft taking off from a base in Italy to do a bombing run in Libya in whatever year that was, 2011. I think is when that was. So there are five major types of war: failed state war, state control war, state formation war, interstate war, and a multilateral war, for lack of a better term. But the way we count the multilateral wars, whether it's in the one in Libya, or intervention of Desert Storm in the Iran-Kuwait war of 1991, we count the Iraq invasion of Kuwait as an interstate war. It's one state attacking another state for the purposes of dealing with an issue between them. And the fact that there is international intervention made it a multilateral war for a time, but it still is the conflict there is still really the Iraq-Kuwait conflict. And that's the same thing with the American invasion of Iraq in 2003, and this is controversial. There's usually a fair bit of pushback on this, and that is that we still define that as a civil war. The war in Iraq is over a civil. It's about the governance of Iraq and about issues within the state of Iraq. It has massive international involvement, but it's not an interstate war. It's not the United States at war against the Iraq for the purpose of resolving an issue between Iraq and the United States. So, you know, people say, well, but it's oil, but it's, you know, so is it really as simple as that? But for our accounting purposes, we still define that as a civil intrastate war, intrastate state control war with major international involvement in it. And there is no civil war, there is no intrastate war that does not have international involvement. No interstate war is just a war in that country. They all depend upon external funding and resources and the intervention of by neighbors and all of that sort of thing. So since 2011. I was going to make a quick point about this, and I apologize for that graph ending in 2011, but it illustrates one point, and that is the level of armed conflict has been in steady decline since during the course of the Cold War. Was it in beginning of 2011, 26 wars in 24 countries. Since then, we've added the wars in Libya and Syria and South Sudan, Egypt, across that threshold, and Ukraine. So that makes five additional wars. So it's gone from 26 to 31 in that area. So it's still the trajectory has been on a decline since then. Multilateral, I was going to say a little bit about the multilateral wars, but we've talked a bit about that, and the interstate wars. They in that quarter century, there were interstate wars. The major war was the Iran-Iraq war, Eritrea, Ethiopia, Azerbaijan, and its neighbor war. And there were interstate wars, but currently there is no interstate war by that definition. There are civil wars with enormous international involvement in them. That's certainly the case. But there isn't a war like the Iran-Iraq war or the Eritrea-Ethiopia war, where two countries have an intractable problem between them, and they've started fighting in order to address that problem. That type of war doesn't exist today. For my money, that's a fairly significant development and achievement. It doesn't mean that they aren't going to break out again. But the UN has an international system that is quite effective in engaging when two countries are in significant dispute. You can take it to the Security Council, and there are commissions and visitations and all of those things but the UN, of course, is much less effective in dealing with conflicts that are internal, primarily internal to a country. So another thing to comment about these wars, that the number of wars is in gradual, modest decline. The level and the level of violence during that quarter century is also in modest decline, with some notable exceptions, Syria, of course, being the primary one, South Sudan quickly becoming a primary exception to it. So there are exceptions to it. But look at the experience of the 20th century and the 21st century, just from the point of view of the number of casualties and deaths due to war. It's just extraordinarily different. In the 20th century, you had World War I, 15, 20 million people killed. World War II, 30, 40, 50 million people killed. in a North Korea, was a major war. You had the Cambodia, the Pol Pot wars of several million people. You had Biafra of millions of people. So we counted war deaths in the tens of millions in the 20th century. In the 21st century, we're counting war deaths in the tens of thousands. In Syria, we're counting, unfortunately, in the hundreds of thousands. But in most cases, the level of war, the level of combat deaths is radically lower. We still produce military forces capable of creating combat deaths in the tens of millions. We all know that, and the nuclear arsenals that are there can produce those kinds of tragic numbers in an instant. So we're still capable of that kind of inhumanity to each other, and we're still preparing to do that more effectively. But so far, in the 21st century, the level of warfare deaths are way, way lower. What is not lower is the level of displacement. The massive displacement there are now 65 million people displaced because of war, the highest in history that we've ever known. In the fight to liberate Mosul and to get ISIS out of Mosul, and I think people of Mosul welcome the removal, but there were just in the past months there were 50,000 people were driven from their homes in this battle over Mosul. In South Sudan, there are regular reports in which there are clashes in which over a weekend in which 100, 200 people are killed, tragic, but as a result of which 20 to 30,000 people are left homeless. They're driven into places where there is absolutely zero social basis for them, and they die at a much higher rate of death than normal as a result of that. So those are in the indirect deaths of war. So the getting finally to the point, and that is that how intrastate wars end. Well, of those, remember there were 70 wars that ended during those 25 years, 1989 to 2014. 14% of them were decided on the battlefield, so they were militarily decisive. Of those, about half governments prevailed, and in about half the insurgents prevailed. An example of governments prevailing is that we recall probably is Sri Lanka, and had a member. A few years back, major battles towards the end of a long-term war finally forced the capitulation of the Tamil Tigers, and that ended that war. What it most certainly did not do was what Rupert Smith said is the point of war, and that is to settle the political conflict that engendered it in the first place. And that most certainly has not happened in Sri Lanka. There's major social and political conflict remains, and in some sense it's a country in a pre-war condition. Great danger of it slipping back into that. Then the other half, just slightly more actually, the insurgents prevailed. So an example of that is the overthrow of the Mengistu regime in Ethiopia after a very long war. It the regime was finally deposed. That settled that issue, and new regime went in and carries on. So if you're just looking at that figure of 6% government prevails, if you as in at the time of the Arab Spring, if you're a government like Syria or Libya, and you're facing major political opposition and the challenge to the regime, if you decide to respond to that political opposition by force, by military means, it's long odds. You've got, given the experience of that quarter century, you got a 6% chance of being successful. And if you're an insurgent and you start fighting, you've got a very limited chance of being successful. But there's one thing that's a little different here. Insurgencies generally don't fight in order to overthrow a government. They fight in order to get a seat at the table. That's really their objective. And so in an insurgent war, the government is losing as long as it's not winning. This is a common aphorism. So the government loses as long as it's not winning. Insurgents win as long as they're not losing. So as long as they continue to fight and are not destroyed like the Sri Lanka destroyed the Tamils, as long as they continue to fight, they're winning because they're ultimately going to get that seat at the table, and there's going to have to be negotiation with them. And so in 50% of the cases, then that's what happened. Those wars were fought to hurting stalemates. The wars didn't end because one side won, and therefore ended the war. The wars ended because both sides realized they could never win, and that the only way they were going to get this thing settled was at the table. So that's 50% of the wars, and then the other 30%, which is a fairly high 36%, which is a fairly high proportion, is that wars that dissolved. That they no one won, no one lost. There weren't any negotiations, but they kind of petered out. So the examples that I've got noted here: Chad in 2013 had been a long-term war, and they just kind of quit the fighting. A good example is the South African war in KwaZulu. This was after Mandela was released, and when there was major fighting between the Zulus, the Inkatha Freedom Party, and the ANC in Zululand, KwaZulu Natal, that area. There was major violence, a lot of people killed in that area during the early part of the 1990s, and that was because the Buthelezi, the leader of the Zulus, was marginalized and wanted to get back in, and so forth. So there was fighting. There was never any negotiation between the Inkatha Freedom Party, the Zulu armed wing, and the ANC. But there were political discussions, and so forth, and gradually Buthelezi just dissipated. The fighting ended and stopped, and it's a pretty peaceful area now. So it's an example of dissolved. There's another example in Ghana, where a similar thing happened, where there in the north there were conflicts over land claims and so forth, in which people just pursued their differences by other means. And in some cases, governments actively develop policies that are more conducive to engaging parties to conflict and in a kind of peace-building way. So a significant number of wars end in that way as well. So, this is, just remember those different types of war. And this is an interesting thing that if you look at state control and state formation wars, so these are wars led by people in groups with a defined political agenda. The defined political agenda is to overthrow the current government and put in a more effective, more just kind of regime in it, or it's to create autonomy or separation for a part of the country. So these are wars that are led, you know, where there's a particular agenda, and these are things that can be negotiated. You can talk about those issues on their agenda, and you can usually identify who's the leader of these movements. And so that means that in relative terms, more of those kinds of wars are settled through negotiation, because of the kind of groups that are in those wars and the objectives that they have. Fewer of them dissolve, so they have to be addressed by them. But in failed state wars, like the war in Kenya, where there's just local violence, there, you see, very few of those are settled by negotiation. That's because it's a much less defined political agenda that they have. It's frustration with local leadership and so forth. The leaders themselves, they tend not to be major political movements that are involved. So who do you? What's the leadership that you can negotiate with, and if you're the government? So much fewer of those end in negotiation, and the overwhelming majority of those end dissolve. That, I mean, in some way or another, the issues that is creating this local violence are addressed and dealt with, and zero are won on the battlefield. You cannot defeat that kind of an opposition. And the trend in wars outside of the Middle East, in particular, the trend in wars is more towards these kind of failed state wars. They're becoming more prominent. So that if you're going to, if you have ambitions for resolving conflict, then more powerful militaries are not going to do the job for you obviously. If you want to advance, you know, develop war prevention capacity, and you want to disarm conflict, you want to find means of mediating and managing conflict by means other than armaments and military, then you need to have some reasonable understanding of what's behind wars. How do they start? Why do they get going? And there's a lot of academic literature, as some of you will know, on this, and people summarize that in different ways. I summarize it in this way, that there are that and the question is not is what's at the root of conflict. The question is what's at the root of political conflict, which is present in every society, but what's at the root of political conflict transforming into armed conflict? What are the conditions that are more likely to lead to that? And it's not a simple cause and effect, but you can identify conditions in which that's more likely to happen than in other conditions. So what needs to be present, obviously, is grievance. Major, significant economic grievance, feelings of economic marginalization, disadvantaged of some income inequality, all of those grievances are central. But for the presence of grievance doesn't alone lead immediately into armed conflict. If the grievance is linked to identity, if you say I'm disadvantaged and I don't get jobs and I can't get out of this poverty spiral because of my religion, or because of my race, or because of the part of the country that I'm living in. Well, that's a much more than the likelihood of that conflict escalating and moving towards violence is greater, because you have a much more clearly identified group that and group solidarity and that to pursue the grievance and so forth. So grievance, and when that grievance is linked to identity, that in each one of these steps, then there's that increases the likelihood of conflict becoming armed conflict. And then there's capacity. You have to have access to the weapons of war, and that's why there is such a thing as regions of conflict, because regions of conflict tend to be regions of in which there's a circulation of small arms and weapons and ammunition, streams of supply trains or streams are established in those regions, so that if you have a grievance and grievance is linked to identity, and you have access to the military means, to small arms and so forth, then that creates the opportunity even more. And that capacity is not only the physical capacity of having access to it, but there's also a political psychological capacity that is there. And capacity isn't quite the right word for it. But I think in the war in South Sudan today, where there's major conflict between the Salva Kiir-led government and the opposition of Riek Machar, which is also basically a Dinka New Era conflict. But I think one of the reasons that they came so quickly to armed conflict is that they've had a culture of that for 50 years. For 50 years, that's the way in which you've addressed, since 1956 essentially, that's the way in which you address political conflict. And so there's a kind of the followers of both sides. There's a tendency to identify resolve by willingness to fight and so forth. So I think that's a case of they're not only, and it's a region that's awash with small arms. So when that government, that new government in South Sudan wasn't working in the conflict, and there was a power struggle between those two guys, then they had the physical capacity, was readily available, but they also had the psychological, political capacity that was within their communities. And then this last one is, I think, is really the big one, and that is the lack of alternative. If you have a sense that there really is no alternative available to you. Look at the, and I do this with a bit of trepidation because I'm long ways from being Middle East expert. But if you look at the wars, the Arab Spring wars, why did Libya and Syria go towards armed conflict very, very quickly, and Egypt did not, Tunisia did not. Like what are the differences between? If you look at Libya and Egypt, for the differences there, well, Syria too. I mean, in grievances are present in all of them, equally so. But the identity, grievance related to identity was much stronger in both Syria and Libya. There was an east west thing that was related to ethnic differences. In Syria, the Alawite and the Shia Sunni thing was much more, so grievance was much more linked to that. Capacity, I think their cultures there of militias and so forth having access to weapons, but a major thing in Egypt was that the army was always created an environment in which there was an openness to talking, I mean, how it ended up in the end is another matter. But there was continuing, ongoing negotiations and meetings and that sort of. There was a sense that it was possible to pursue this politically, and the opposition there was not identity centered, but it was from poor to rich a wide cross section of people. But the lack of alternative, I think, is a very big factor. And remember, that's when insurgents fight against governments, they're not expecting to depose that government. They're expecting to get a seat at the table. They're expecting to create and to have access to an alternative to fighting. I don't think that's a kind of naive notion about all insurgents have pure motives and are only looking for political solutions. I mean, these conflicts get very, very complicated. But if you want to do something about war prevention and disarming conflict, then the international community seems to me has a very clear political agenda, and that is a massively increased attention to the creation of alternative forums and forums through which the disaffected believe that they have a reasonable chance of stating their case and having it heard. So that I've used this old 5 D's things way too many times, but I mean, if you're going to resolve conflict and pursue it by means other than armed force, you've got to focus on development, addressing the grievances that are very present and very real. Democracy, that's really a term for governance, but governance doesn't start with D, so it doesn't quite work there. So you've got to create public institutions in which people who are aggrieved have a measure of trust in, and believe that if they go through those public mechanisms, their grievances are actually going to be heard. And if you lose public trust in public institutions, then I think you're in very big trouble. And I think, by the way, if you have major political leaders who have a hard time telling the truth, that doesn't do anything for public trust. For trust in public institutions, and it's a danger. It's a serious thing. The United States is a long way from becoming a failed state and going into that kind of war. But there's the erosion of a sense of political institutions having legitimacy is something that we should be very worried about and very wary of. So diplomacy, well, that's conflict resolution, and then. Defense and could say quite a lot about the way in which military forces can make a contribution and do make contributions to the resolution of conflict and I maintain, and I think it is correct, that there is a fundamental distinction between war fighting and peace support. And the use of military forces in peace support operations. In war fighting, the whole objective is to go around the political process and to try to enforce and produce political ends that you want to enforce. In peace support operations, it's the whole point of the military exercise is to try to facilitate a political process within that country. And that requires a lot more discussion, but I'm going to end there and invite your comment.